Good evening and welcome to Coast once again. Great to have you with us. And tonight's show is the usual good mix of serious news and some of the funnier sidelines to the news happening all around the world.
Yes, tonight we've got everything from how to find a husband in the Midwest to how to lose one in New York.
And all the truly important world happenings, courtesy of our newsman, John Mangos.
Yes, Terry, thank you. A big news day, including a breakthrough in the trucking dispute, with some of the big rigs rolling again.
And we get the real story on Jackie O. Just what is she like behind those sunglasses?
And the cameras turn on you as we screen some more entrants in our home video competition.
We are having such a ball in the office looking at all the stuff you're sending in. All in all, little kids doing number ones and number twos seem to be the favourite.
Yes, but our number one priority now is the news, and here's John to tell us all about it.
Terry, thank you. Yes, as I mentioned, a breakthrough in the truckies' dispute tonight, with rebel drivers agreeing to return to work. A stormy meeting with TWU representatives from four states ended with the 500 drivers agreeing to end their picket at Wodonga on the Victorian-New South Wales border. Their decision was prompted by a revised package of road safety concessions. They include abolishing the $500 fine for logbook violations and an end to the new speeding fines introduced by New South Wales in the wake of the Kempsey and Grafton bus crashes. The Federal Opposition has dismissed Labor's economic statement as a sellout that will lead to a recession. Federal Treasurer Paul Keating announced the package today, offering more than $1 billion in personal tax cuts.
Despite Treasurer Keating's attempts to promote the statement as something of a mini-budget, the emphasis is obviously on wooing voters. Even he admitted that.
What is the policy of a government going to an election? That's what it is.
Tax cuts worth $7.50 per week are offered to the average earner from the start of 1991, with a change in tax scales favouring those earning around the $20,000 per annum mark. According to the Treasurer, the estimated cost of those cuts is $2.5 billion per year and not a problem. The wage deal with the ACTU provides for a 1.5% rise in the December quarter of this year and a flat $12 increase 6 months later. All up, tax and wage improvements should put an extra $50 per week in the pocket of the average earner. In addition, the present dole scheme is to be scrapped in favour of a 12-month job search allowance. Meanwhile, opposition leader Andrew Peacock, campaigning in Brisbane, faced a political storm over reports that the National Crime Authority is investigating Liberal Party President John Elliott. Mr Elliott's called the story politically motivated innuendo. However, the Prime Minister, also on the campaign trail, denies that.
The Australian Democrats have released their own economic policy for the federal election. Leader Janine Haines has pledged to discourage foreign borrowing, impose a surcharge on luxury imports, and fight against bank deregulation.
Senator Haines' day started slowly. While waiting for the Walk for Want activities to begin, she decided it was a good opportunity to talk to some of Adelaide's street kids. Later, a trip to Christie's Beach and the release of the Democrats' economic platform. Senator Haines says while the Democrats aren't able to form government and implement their policies, they do have an influence on the major parties.
If we're not there at all, then there is no counter-argument to the economic rationalists, to the people who say, dig it up, chop it down, shoot it and sell it as fast as possible, and Australia will be a terrific place to live, because it won't be.
And she says her party's economic policy has remained steady while both major parties have moved to the right.
The policy argues against deregulation of the banking industry. Senator Haines says it hasn't helped home buyers or small businesses. Democrats also call for import restrictions as a means of addressing the balance of trade deficit.
Senator Haines says budget surpluses should not be used to pay foreign debt, but channeled into areas such as the social security system. As for the environment, she says while both major parties claim to be newly green, the Democrats have consistently put forward long-term environmental policies.
Taiwan has bowed to international pressure and announced it's phasing out driftnet fishing. The so-called Wall of Death operation has been condemned by environmentalists for the senseless killing of thousands of dolphins and other sea life. Taiwan says it stopped issuing driftnet permits and will completely ban driftnetting by mid-1992. And a bush tracker claims to have seen a Tasmanian tiger alive and well and in, of all places, Western Australia. Now, that's a long way from where the last known tiger died. In fact, experts claim they haven't been on the mainland for 3,000 years. Maybe this one was on holiday.
Snapped just 100 kilometres from Perth near Mandurah, these photographs are offered as proof of a legendary creature living in our midst. Its head obscured by a tree, it was caught digging a hole to bury a freshly killed kangaroo.
So there's no doubt in your mind?
No
doubt. It
could
have been anything else?
No, nothing else. It's definitely a thylacine.
But officially, the only thylacine in Western Australia is this one, stuffed and well and truly dead in the West Australian Museum.
The last known Tasmanian tiger died in the Hobart Zoo 54 years ago. The island state thought to be its last refuge before the species disappeared. But Perth bushman and tracker Kevin Cameron says he came face to face with the tiger as a hired gun for someone who wanted to prove its existence with a body.
I was hired to kill one, to blow its head off. And when I actually got it in the sights of the Magnum handgun they gave me, I wouldn't shoot because it's a very extinct looking animal.
According to Cameron, the Tasmanian tiger lives up to its fearsome reputation as a predator. It eats the heads off kangaroos, tears out the heart and drinks blood. But it's timid, alert and keeps well away from human sceptics. Reese Whitby, Coast to Coast.
Now, if a good mate of mine had seen that story, he'd be prompted to ask the question, I wonder what they taste like.
Yeah, what's the answer?
Oh, with a little...
The answer is liberal.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that their campaign?
Something like that.
Oh, just a political right, touch there. Actually, they should get the guy who's pushing that story to push for one of the Labor or Liberal, I think.
It looked a bit like a rat to me. What did it look like to you?
I think it smelt like a rat, yeah. Yes. It is now 100 days since the first break in the Berlin Wall. And while demolition continues enthusiastically, the thorny problem of reunification has become the main focus of attention for East and West Berliners. Both sides seem to have some reservations about each other's lifestyle.
It came down slowly, exactly 100 days after the first historic break, cheered on by Berliners who stayed up all night to watch it tumble. These latest bites into the wall will eventually become a 4 kilometre long gap. A mere 3 months ago, this section of the wall near the Brandenburg Gate was impenetrable. It cut off the east view of the Reichstag, Germany's parliament building up until the war, which once again may become the seat of government. But recent polls have indicated that two-thirds of the West German population now believe the pace of change, the rush towards one Germany, is going too fast. Michael Viet works as a machinist in East Berlin and earns 10 times less than his counterparts in the West. He worries about reunification.
I think masses of our workers won't meet the demands of a united Germany. In my factory, 70 to 80% are afraid of losing their jobs.
Likewise, in West Berlin, Wolfgang Kukowski, a technician, thinks a united Germany will mean a lowering of his lifestyle.
Also kommen wir bestimmt.
Well, as far as my colleagues are concerned, they also think that you will have to pay higher taxes.
A few of Berlin's remaining hippies have even set up camp in an area once tagged no man's land. The guards and the dogs ignore them. Now the souvenir hunters are grabbing the last bits before a thin wire fence goes up instead, and in a matter of months, that will be gone too. I'm Robert Penfold reporting for Coast to Coast.
Well, I suppose they've already taken the first step toward capitalism, selling the wall.
Yeah, it's all over. I hear a few bits for sale in Australia. People flogging around the place.
You could sell anything.
Sell a bit of concrete.
Actually, I've got a bit in my boot I might sell.
Yeah, really? So if you're a gullible viewer, ring us. We could get some, couldn't we?
We'll sell you bits of the Berlin Wall, yes.
Now, Merv Hughes, the great cricketer, but he's also known as the kissing cricketer, has a new job. He's flogging power tools.
Australia's fast bowling hero launched a new career today, far removed from the cricket oval, but one that will see that familiar hair above the top lip on just about every street corner in Australia and around the world. Hughes is now putting the runs on the board for Black & Decker's power tool division.
It's a good sort of opportunity for me to sort of career outside cricket, where over a couple of years, I think, last couple of years, it's been a bit of a worry, what am I going to do after cricket?
But his new role won't see Merv's antics disappearing from the cricket arena. Although he is currently recovering from knee surgery, the cult hero will be missing from the early matches in New Zealand.
The one days are virtually ruled out. Hopefully I can come up for the test.
Hughes' antics have endeared him to the world's cricket followers. Special kind of humour, and that handlebar will still be part of his career. But unlike John Newcomb's moustache, this one won't be insured.
A lot of people say it looks terrible on me, but I don't have to look at it, so it doesn't worry me.
There's no love lost, and the big fellow would love to be on his home track on Friday in the first encounter with Pakistan in the World Series final, a game that he knows will be tough, but even tougher for him as he sits it out in the dressing room.
If it goes down to the best of three, then I think it's better off for everyone because it just means the competition's been fairly well even.
Rob Gaylard, Coast to Coast.
Well, good luck to him. If music be the food of love, play on. That old saying doesn't have the same lyrical quality these days, however, as music becomes more and more mechanical. The latest trend is towards the creation of totally robotic musicians. They sound just the same as a pop group, but they don't smash up hotel rooms.
Two hearts.
What will they think of next is probably a question that springs to mind. But if you're into microchips and macro rock, then this is for you. It's not raunchy, but it is computer perfect. I mean, who better to play a bit of synthesized pop than these three chaps? Their first Melbourne gig is the NEC Showcase at the Sports and Entertainment Centre. And while they're unlikely to be mobbed by hardware groupies, the trio are worth plugging into. It may seem like just the latest gimmick in the high-tech world, but the robots are the result of $1 million worth of research and development. It brings a whole new meaning to the phrase state of the art. But Jason Donovan can rest easy. The robot band is hardly pin-up material. Joe Hall, Coast to Coast.
And I'm glad my kids are in bed because they saw that. They'd certainly want them. And coming up after this break, some of the sillier entries in our funniest home video competition.
Can Thunderbirds and Captain Scarlet save the world? Find out when London's Mime Theatre Project brings to life on stage Thunderbirds FAB. This hilarious tribute to the cult TV series features characters like Lady Penelope.
International Wrestling.
Thunderbirds 1 and 2. Scott and Virgil.
FAB.
Brains.
This is top level stuff.
And many more. It's the funniest show on four legs. Thunderbirds FAB is coming to a theatre near you. Don't miss it. FAB.
That's it.
Another road, another long day.
See you later.
Right. To chasing the dream of that day.
So, perfect way, eh?
Let's have a Coke.
Can't beat it.
Can you tell us where the waves are?
Emma.
We came from somewhere else, and we made ourselves a home here in the sun. We were English, we were Irish, we were Italian, Polish, Greek, and we found a place with room for everyone. Now we're big and bold and beautiful and strong and young and free, but we still got room to grow and room to learn. And there's still our Aussies out there, though they're not Aussies yet, who are patiently awaiting for their turn. So let's keep our hearts wide open. That's the way we've learned to be. To the world, that's Australia's claim to fame. That everyone's born equal, that everyone's born free, and we welcome anyone who feels the same.
Welcome back. When you go out and buy a car or a fridge, the manufacturers don't invite you to come and check out how the product is being made at the factory. But when you're paying the sort of money our Air Force is shelling out for a fleet of new fighter planes, things are different.
The Northrop assembly line in Los Angeles, where they make the tail end of the F-18 fighter. 75 of these have already gone down under in a deal that cost Australia billions. Having spent so much, our Defence Department still keeps a close watch on the project, through the eyes of 27-year-old Murray Stimson.
This is a structural model, and we use that to obtain the stresses and the loads on the aircraft.
Getting to know the stress and fatigue limitations of the F-18 is crucial in determining how much mileage the Australian Air Force can get out of the jets.
It's also vital in assessing what they can and can't do.
We don't want any surprises for our Australian pilots.
As lives depend on getting things right here, workers are told to imagine themselves in the pilot's position. Murray Stimson could think of nothing better.
I would very much like to fly the F-18. It's always been a dream of mine.
But heart surgery as a youngster ruled Murray out for a Top Gun career. He hasn't been grounded altogether, though. It's not supersonic, but with a little help, it does fly, or rather glide, high above California's Mojave Desert.
The gliding is nothing like flying a high-performance jet, except that there's that freedom and exhilaration.
Oh, this is an elevator, man. This is great. A lift.
I'm in almost a fighter-type cockpit here, and we do all the sorts of manoeuvres that jet fighters do.
He dreamt of flying the real thing. He finds the compromise unreal.
You feel like king of the mountain.
Woo!
In California, Stephen Fennelly, Coast to Coast.
Well, the cartoon character Ginger Meggs would spend most of his days down at the creek catching yabbies, and I guess it's something most Australians have had a go at some time or another. Now, Ginger's been doing it for about, 50 years, just for fun. But yabbies are now a high-priced gourmet food. So if Ginger and the rest of us had taken it seriously, we might all be rich by now.
Tony Bishop is a yabby farmer. But today, his 45-hectare property at Bordertown is crawling with scientists as well as crustaceans.
The market's a little bit reliant on what's happening in the wild catch, but if we can get out and establish good export markets, I think, you know, it's a big future.
For the first time in Australia, scientists and the Department of Fisheries are putting yabby farming under the microscope, away from their laboratories. Tony's homemade yabby grabber swings into action, sucking a rich crop from the oozing mud. Operating from four experimental ponds stocked with 48,000 yabbies last April, are Adelaide University lecturer Dr. Mike Geddes and his team.
Well, we've had these yabbies stocked for 10 months now, and when we stocked them, we knew everything about their size and their age. And now, 10 months later, we're coming back to do a complete harvest.
Thousands of them, some weighing 100 grams, are being collected, counted and weighed to determine what ponds, food or conditions provide best results and help the breeding program for the so-called Cherex destructor.
To be sent to restaurants throughout Australia is potentially a huge market. Small yabbies are worth about 7 cents each. Large yabbies get $1.20 each. And monsters like this, you name your own price.
A scientific paper will be produced to help yabby farmers crack an export market they say could be worth millions. David Kellett, Coast to Coast.
Yeah, sounds like a great idea, but I guess it might be a little difficult to round them up come branding time, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Well, it would be. How the hell would you do it?
Yes, yes.
Well, they've got a sucker. They do suck them up, which is... Andy?
I think this is a good time to go to our Coast to Coast competition, Australia's funniest home videos.
So if you've got a home video camera, you can enter our home video contest and maybe win a wonderful prize like this JVC Super VHS video movie camera and its whiz-bang partner, the JVC editing unit.
You may be saying, yes, I have a video camera, but my videos aren't funny. Well, you can still enter. Make yourself a funny video. Look at these amateur Woody Allens and Mel Brooks from America.
6 foot, 7 foot, 8 foot punch.
When the great tally man in the sky comes to tally your banana, will you be ready?
6 foot, 7 foot, 8 foot punch. Daylight gone, Monday won't go home. Easy day, yo. Daylight gone, Monday won't go home.
People who lip-sync in your rearview mirror may appear larger than they are. This is Mary Bogdan making a pig of herself.
Don't you know it's early in the morning?
to find my way home. How could I be so wrong?
Is Christopher Cox from Hayward, California buy clothes? You guessed it, at a half off sale.
Very good. And if you think you can do as well or perhaps better than that, send us your tape queued up to the funny bit. Let's take a look at some of the Aussie entries we've received so far.
Come up and say hi. He's a koala. He won't hurt you.
But then again, well, son, maybe it's their mating season. That's not the way you ride a horse, honey. He might not like it. Princess Anne, eat your heart out. Oh, no, don't cut his hair. It's having his hair cut. Oh, no. Anthony, please. Don't. Oh, great, a full tank. We'll pay for the dry cleaning.
Well, now we know why the bloke was wearing a towel. And the kid in...
Maybe it's their mating season. That's not the way you ride a horse, honey. He might not like it. Princess Anne, eat your heart out. Oh, no, don't cut his hair. He hates having his hair cut. Oh, no. Anthony, please. Don't. Oh, great, a full tank. We'll pay for the dry cleaning.
Well, now we know why the bloke was wearing a towel. And the kid in question was little Anthony, doing a good job of anointing himself. Send your entries to Australia's Funniest Home Videos, P.O. Box 566, Willoughby 2068. And don't forget your name, address and phone number on the label.
And coming up after the break, the lonesome cowboys who can't find a cowgirl to keep them company out on the range.
And a group of Bulgarian folk singers who are in the running to win a prestigious Grammy Award.
New album, Foreign Affair.
Bushfires are a lethal threat to lives and homes. This summer offers no exception. If fire strikes your neighbourhood, your home, when well prepared and defended, can offer the safest refuge. Take cover inside. Change into full cover clothing, preferably woolen jumpers, heavy slacks, a hat, and solid leather footwear, no matter how uncomfortable it seems. Draw curtains to shield against radiant heat. If time permits, douse down the house exterior before the firefront arrives. Watch for penetration of windblown sparks and embers, and only venture outside when the firefront has passed to patrol for spot fires. It's best to keep off the roads. Be vigilant for several hours after the main threat, and the CFA stresses these points. Take cover, cover up, and prepare your defenses.
As a mother of two teenagers,
He created an American institution for a character that should have been in one. voted as the voice most likely to impress in primary school playgrounds, Clarence made a living of it for the rest of his life. And he even appeared with the great Ronald Reagan, who stood well back to avoid confusion. He was only too happy to oblige when fans asked him that time-honored request. I suppose a Donald Duck is out of the question. Still in the world of art, it was on this day in 1855 that painter Frederick McCubbin was born in West Melbourne. Here we see his originally titled work, Where the Hell Am I? Along with Tom Roberts, he set up the first artist's camp at Box Hill and set about romanticizing life in the Australian bush. His work now brings huge sums at auction, and here's why. This one was originally titled, Hum a Few Bars and I'll See If I Can Pick Up the Tune. Frederick McCubbin, our first brushman of the bush. It's alleged actor Christopher Atkin's birthday. He was born on this day in 1961, which shows you how desperate we were for something to tell you. Here he is looking at the sea. But he didn't become famous until he looked at the sea with Brooke Shields. They starred in the remake of Blue Lagoon. In retrospect, a bad career move for both of them. But if you had any doubt, it did prove that his acting was at its best underwater.
There are some of the things that happened on this day. Now to something that might well happen tomorrow. There's still time to get a bet on for this year's Grammy Awards, if you're really quick. And our hot tip from Hollywood is in the best traditional folk recording category. All the wise money is on a Bulgarian trio, which is giving the Gypsy Kings a run for their pesos.
It is music from another time, passed on by generations of Bulgarian women. Songs of love and renewal, sung full-throated and clear to carry across fields and mountains. You can hear the influence of five centuries of Turkish domination in Bulgaria. People here say the music has helped them get through hard times, including 44 years of repressive communist rule. The music was hardly known outside Bulgaria's mountains until recently. The Bulgarian State Radio and Television Female Vocal Choir has filled halls in Europe and America since its record became a cult phenomenon, selling 200,000 copies in North America alone. Former Beatle George Harrison is a fan of the choir's three soloists who sing as a trio and have already appeared on the American television program Sunday Night.
The Trio Bulgarka.
Now, Bulgarian singers are enjoying commercial success in the West, even helping to sell shampoo on British TV. And the Trio Bulgarka sang backup for British rocker Kate Bush on her latest album. Some charge it's all a kind of cultural strip mining by Western musicians. But Kate Bush and others say Bulgaria's mystical sounds will change the way Western musicians think.
I was devastated. I think everyone that hears it for the first time is. It's incredibly powerful music.
When we visited them recently, the girls from the music school in the remote mountain town of Shiroka Luka weren't even aware that their special way of singing is gaining a wider audience in the West. For them, as it was for their mothers, the music is just part of life.
Oh, they're great. They'll bolt it in, or as they would say in Bulgarian, unskadunk onk.
I don't know. I think they take a little bit of getting used to. I mean, initially, yeah. They sound like one spouse singing in the shower. Don't you think?
No, I could just actually look at them. They're beautiful looking women. Aren't they stunning looking
Absolutely
women?
Absolutely beautiful.
I mean, that's not sexist. I mean, they look fantastic and fresh.
I think that they will give Cher a run for their money with those costumes. She'd be worried, wouldn't he?
No. I mean, Cher hardly wears anything in some of her things, but they at least covered.
Yeah, I guess they've gone to the opposite extreme,
yeah,
haven't they?
Yeah, that's what you meant. They're pretty. After the break, back to the rat race with a newspaper war that's raging in America.
Sex, infidelity, beauty, power, lust.
I mean, what could be better for a front page story in this town? Hello again, and hello again to John Mangos with the latest news. John.
Thank you very much, Gretel. Rebel truckies have reluctantly agreed to close down their picket of the New South Wales-Victorian border. The decision came after the Greiner government decided to abandon some of its new road rules.
Drivers began the picket at the weekend, claiming the road safety package agreed to by the TWU in New South Wales fell short of the mark. But a day of discussions with the government produced two concessions: the scrapping of increased speeding fines brought in last year and an end to fines of $500 for logbook violations. While the truckies also won ground on the introduction of speed limiters and the 100k speed limit, many were reluctant to end their picket. With pledges from the TWU leadership to push their case, truckies finally voted to accept the package. The picket line began to break up immediately as freight rolled once again across the border. Russell Bishop in Wodonga, Coast to Coast.
Federal opposition leader Andrew Peacock has described the government's wage tax accord as a sham that'll leave the average Australian worse off than before the election. Originally described by Mr. Peacock as an attempt to bribe voters, it now appears Treasurer Keating agrees.
The policy of a government going to an election, that's what it is.
The accord offers average earners tax cuts of $7.50 per week starting next year. Mr. Keating says that, combined with wage increases, will give the average worker an extra $50 a week. Trading on the Australian stock market fell, but regained some points following Treasurer Keating's release of Labor's economic blueprint. The All Ordinaries finished down more than 6 points. In overseas markets, the Nikkei Dow suffered its third biggest one-day drop, with Japanese investors fearing a rise in worldwide interest rates. London's FT 100 was down as well, and our dollar dropped 0.5 cent, and gold closed steady. Good news, singer Kate Sobrano has been named Rock Performer of the Year at the Mo Awards in Sydney. Kate's mother, Cherie, accepted the award, telling the 700-strong crowd that Kate was taking a well-earned rest in the country writing new songs. Other winners were Kylie Minogue, jazz whiz James Morrison, and rockers Paul Kelly and the Messengers. And that's all the latest news, and I hand back now to Terry and Gretel.
What about the Bulgarian folk singers? What
wonderful
happened?
Music.
But they didn't win a Mo Award.
No, but a few of the girls had Mo's, if you looked carefully.
Oh!
Thanks, John. Thank you very much. Now, if you think the papers had a field day here when Susan and Sir Frank Renouf had their very public split, imagine the fun the American tabloids are having with their current celebrity marital bust-up. The seriously rich Trumps are daggers drawn in what promises to be longer running and more ostentatious than anything Alexis, Sue Ellen or Lady Susan ever encountered.
How sweet it is indeed for New York's tabloid newspapers, making the most of the divorce battle between America's richest couple, Donald and Ivana Trump. A divorce battle? More a tabloid battle, as the masters of gee whiz journalism relish a story that's got everything.
Sex, infidelity, beauty, power, lust. I mean, what could be better for a front page story in this town?
Everyone wants to read about the latest happenings behind the doors of the Trump household as the Trump solicitors try to come to a deal that'll bring some peace to the warring factions. And everyone wants to watch it on TV.
The topic is Trump versus Trump.
Tongues were wagging about Donald and Ivana Trump.
Trump the war took an interesting turn over the weekend.
Ivana's so stressed by the divorce and attention it's getting that she's seeking solace from her cardinal.
I don't blame the media, but my life is more difficult because it's so very public.
The gossip columnist who broke the news a fortnight ago is wondering aloud if it's gone too far.
This has been a media circus. I have been one of its performers.
But the tabloid editors are confident of more big-selling front pages to come.
My dream front page, and we'll probably never get it, is Marla Maples speaks out, colon, Donald was no great shakes.
After divorce, you have the most eligible bachelor and the most eligible bachelorette in America. So this could go on for
years,
at least a decade.
Incredible, isn't it? I wonder why there's not so much publicity about someone who is just, you know, an average worker. Why is it that because they are known, people are fascinated by what's going on behind the scenes and the problems they're having with their marriage?
Because I think people like to see that perfection doesn't really exist. Lots of money, good looks, everything that anyone ever wanted, and it doesn't bring you happiness.
Donald Trump, I read his book, Fascinating Man, and one of his sayings was that if you're going to be thinking, you might as well think big. And I think that his wife, Ivana, might be holding into that right now.
Maybe that's why she's divorcing him. And one lady who has come in for her fair share of gossip over the years is America's former First Lady, Jackie Bouvier Kennedy Onassis, or Jackie O, as I prefer to call her. Anyway, even though she's now a humble working girl struggling on a mere $45,000 a year and driving a 16-year-old BMW, she still fascinates people, especially her butcher.
I want to be Jackie Onassis. I want to wear a pair of dark sunglasses.
She's aged 60 and we're still fascinated by her. Once the most public woman in the world as America's glamorous First Lady, she's spotted only occasionally these days heading in for work from her New York apartment. Her constant companion of the past 10 years is married but separated from his Orthodox Jewish wife. The Jackie O watchers have been doing their homework.
Maurice Templeton is very much like Jack. He's interested in the arts. He speaks foreign languages. They're frequently seen in little cozy restaurants talking French to each other.
Jackie and Maurice aren't likely to marry. His wife won't grant him a divorce. She's dazzled many men in her time with her charm and intelligence, but friends admit she has faults.
She's a very extravagant person. She spends money like, proverbial spending money like water. She always has. She drove her father crazy, charging things up at Saks and Bloomingdale's.
Her butcher on Madison Avenue remembers the good days when Jackie was married to Aristotle Onassis and spent anything from up to $30,000 on shopping sprees for parties.
Roast suckling pigs, baby lambs, you name it, they had it.
Jackie has a plush apartment overlooking New York Central Park, a country property where she spends August and September, and a weekend getaway in a ritzy area of New Jersey. She might be extravagant, but still drives the 16-year-old BMW she bought when married to Aristotle. She's paid $45,000 a year as an editor at Doubleday, and occasionally, very occasionally, lends her name to a good cause.
I think we all realize how important it is to save these great and beautiful buildings.
This is one of the last pictures we have of Jackie, taken before she disappeared from view and had a facelift. Before that, her last public appearance was with her children at a ceremony to commemorate the late President Kennedy. Her riding partner has nothing but praise for her.
She's a very friendly person, you know. She talks to everybody, has a good time, always smiling.
But her cousin is not so keen.
She can be a little vindictive in her public, in her personal relations. I think if someone crosses her, you know, that person is never forgiven. When we do encounter each other, she's exceedingly cold.
Love her or lump her, she'll always be a fascinating part of America in the view of the Jackie Watchers.
Some of the images of her are so engraved on all of our minds, that image of her with that pink suit splattered with blood, the sense of Camelot, and then combined with that, she will never give interviews, she won't talk to people at length. It's probably that Garbo syndrome. She certainly has created this great sense of mystery about herself that persists to this day.
Yeah, and very respected in America too when they carry out polls as to who's respected and who is the best dressed and who has got the most class. She's the lady who comes out on top every time.
Doesn't it annoy you, people like this cousin who come out of the woodwork and speak badly of others? Would your cousins have a hoot what you're really like?
Oh, it'd be boring. Willesee family, dull and boring, nothing.
Yeah, you're right.
Well, nothing much. But how much do they pay for these books? You get good money? If you're a publisher and, I'm not too busy these days, give us a yell. After the break, we go to the farm country of the American Midwest and find out how lonely life is out there for a man without a woman.
Welcome back. If you've noticed that the quality of the programs they're showing on television has improved over the last couple of weeks, it's because the all-important rating surveys are on again after the Christmas break. Here's a summary of the first week's results out today.
The first week of the ratings year saw a change in leadership, with Channel 7 pushing Nine aside to take out first prize in Sydney. The city's most watched program was National 9 News, 4 points ahead of its nearest rival, stablemate A Current Affair. Seven's Hey Dad scored a convincing third with 27 points. The much-publicised MGM deal enabled Channel 7 to romp home in the movie stakes, with Three Men and a Baby hitting a high of 36 and Ruthless People a 31. The late night honours went to Steve Vizard's Tonight Live, scoring a peak of 9, while Coast to Coast notched up a 6 in its debut week. In Melbourne, the stations crossed the line in the same order, 7 in the lead from 9 and 10. National 9 News retained its position on top rung of the ladder, with A Current Affair and A Country Practice tying for second. Once again, the movies were a winner for Channel 7. Three Men and a Baby peaking at 33, with Ruthless People on 30. And the majority of Melbourne's night owls tuned in to Tonight Live at 10:30, while Coast to Coast peaked at 7.
Yeah, well done, Steve. We're only 5 minutes into the first quarter, so watch out. It's about to happen. Now, the image of the man on the land in America is still the macho, tough cowboy who is traditionally a loner. But the reality is different, and many of the cowpokes are desperate for the love of a real woman. Singles bars are too far away, so they do their courting by mail order with a book of stamps, a ballpoint pen, and a catalogue.
Nebraska cattleman Neil Spear knows that it can get pretty hard in the saddle. And it can also get pretty lonely back at the old homestead when you're miles from town.
It gets kind of lonesome being out here at times. It really does.
Neil's not the only one who feels the coyote's lonesome cry tug at his heart. And on Saturday night, the night spots of Gooberville, USA, ring to the same tale.
All of a sudden, I'm 36, and about 2 years ago, I decided it's time, Glenn, I should get married and start having a family.
What, you know, the family farm is built around is the family, and I'm lacking that.
And let's face it, out here there's not a lot of choice for either sex.
You might not meet the man of my dreams here tonight, but he might have a brother down the road or something.
So two enterprising people, Marcy and good old Marlon Gum, have put together a newsletter where lonely people from farming communities can meet by mail and organise to get together for a fun-filled night of gay abandon. The closest town to Neil has a population of just 35, and most of them have the same surname. So he has to do a 500-kilometre round trip for the chance of any worthwhile social life.
It's worth it to me to spend a little money and to drive that far.
It's a similar story for hundreds of other farm people all over the state. And until Miss Wright does come along, Neil will just have to keep riding into the sunset with both hands firmly on the reins.
Isn't cowpoke an unfortunate term of reference for those lonely men? Keep trying, guys, but if you find the right girl, be prepared to ask yourself that all-important question.
Are you ready for marriage?
We call this Cupid's checklist. First, do you have similar backgrounds? Second, are you real friends? And third, do you both understand marriage?
Golly, Mr. Hall, I don't know the answers to all those questions. I just know that I'm in love with Sue. Is that bad?
No, that's good.
Maybe that's not so good. The modern housewife may be shocked to find that her place is in the kitchen.
Today's kitchen is built not only for efficiency, but for comfort and right living. The kitchen has come back into its own with ideas like these. Gaily patterned, washable wallpaper makes the kitchen a friendlier place for the housewife to work in. A storage cabinet on wheels with hard top for slicing and chopping. This can be wheeled to whatever part of the kitchen the housewife is working in and put away when not in use. A desk to fit into the corner between the refrigerator and the wall. Here, the modern housewife can plan meals, ring the grocer, or talk to her friends while the meal cooks.
Are you ready for marriage?
Welcome back. Jazz violinist Stefan Grappelli has been making beautiful music for a long time now. He's back in Australia on another visit, and his fiddle is as sweet as ever.
Before us, two of the world's youngest violinists playing to one of the world's oldest. Though he's nearly 80 years older, Stefan Grappelli is clearly delighted with this concert in his honour.
Ah, che meraviglia. Bravo.
It's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for seven of our brightest young talents to be heard and to hear the undisputed world's best jazz violinist. At 82, you'd think his fiddling days should be nearly over, but his energy carries him from concert to concert around the world. Few musicians ever produce 400 albums, and few show such a zest for life. Here, he's teamed up with Yehudi Menuhin.
You like to try?
Grappelli's fiddle is over 200 years old, a Guadagnini, yet he's happy to let Tanya Davis give it a go. So what did he play for them?
He's just so good. I'd love to be able to improvise like that.
I've never really met anyone that good closely before.
People ask Grappelli when he's going to retire, but any of the musicians in this room could answer that.
The thing about a musician is that once you become one, you don't really finish till the day you die. I bet you've heard that a thousand times.
So, fiddling doesn't make you go blind. Let's see what sort of weather Australia is turning on tomorrow.
Cairns, a few showers, 31. Townsville, the same showers, 32. Brisbane, a near relative of the other showers, 28. Sydney, arty showers and thundery, 28. Canberra, second cousin showers, 28. Melbourne, late showers with a note from their mum, 30. Hobart, thinking about showers, cloudy, 25. Adelaide, shower-free, 28. Darwin, raining up a storm, 33. Perth, rainless, 33. Alice Springs, widespread dryness, 38.
And that's all there is. There ain't no more.
And of course, we'll be along to bring you another edition of Coast to Coast tomorrow night at the same time.
And tonight, we're going to leave you with some more of violin master Stefan Grappelli. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.